Here again is Dr. Donald Gray Barnhouse with a message entitled, Men Whom God Struck Dead.
Through the Lord Jesus Christ, we come unto thee, our Father and our God, and in the Holy Spirit. We ask thee that thou shalt guide us in this hour, in our listening, that we may hear beyond the human words, the divine voice, and that thou shalt speak to our hearts, that we may be blessed. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. If any member of a municipal council should introduce a resolution that the death penalty be inflicted on anyone who rode a bicycle at night without a light, or parked on the wrong side of the street, or on a pedestrian who crossed the street against the lights, his colleagues would declare that he had lost his mind. They would advise him that the death penalty is reserved for the most serious offenses, murder in the first degree, high treason, or desertion in the face of the enemy. In the Bible, however, there are several instances in which God himself struck men dead. And in practically every case, the offense was, we might say, trivial compared with what we regard as gross sin. On the other hand, there are men in the Bible who were guilty of great sin and even crime, but who were forgiven and raised to places of great honor and usefulness. Abraham lied, was willing to sacrifice the honor of his wife to save his own skin. But later on, he came back to God, repented, was greatly used by God, and was honored with the title Friend of God. Moses was a murderer and a fugitive from justice, and was restored by God and commissioned to lead his people from bondage to freedom. Through Moses, God gave his laws to the world. We must not forget that the Ten Commandments, with that commandment, thou shalt not kill, were originally put into the hands of a man who himself was a murderer, but a forgiven and restored murderer. David committed adultery and committed murder to conceal his adultery. But God forgave him, called him a man after his own heart, and promised that the Messiah would descend from him. Peter denied the Lord Jesus Christ, not for money as Judas did, but for fear of a servant girl. Yet the risen Lord commissioned him to use the keys to the kingdom, that is, to be the one who first preached to the Jews on the day of Pentecost, and finally in the house of Cornelius, to the Gentiles. And Peter wrote two books of the New Testament. When, on the other hand, we look at the men who were struck dead by God, we find that, compared with these of whom we have spoken, their lives were on a higher plane. The first two, Nadab and Abihu, were men against whom there is no suspicion of carnality, or of those great passions that incite to violence. How shall we describe them? Nadab and Abihu were young men of whom any mother could be proud. They had the physical soundness required for service in the Levitical priesthood. They were nephews of Moses and sons of the high priest Aaron. Surely there was no family in Israel more noble than theirs. And yet, on the day of their ordination, they were struck dead by God Almighty himself. Why? Today, when a crime is committed, the officers frequently reconstruct the scene and look at the place where the murder was committed. Now, if we do this and find out where these men were struck dead, we can understand some of the meaning of their death. Remember that they died in the tabernacle in the midst of performing their services. In the outer court were the brazen altar where the lamb was sacrificed, and the laver where the priests washed themselves. The building itself was divided into two parts. The first veil covered the entrance to the holy place, which contained the table of showbread, the golden candlestick, the altar of incense, which stood before the inner veil. It was just in front of this veil that the two boys were killed by God. This inner veil was the great veil that was torn from top to bottom when our Lord died on the cross. It concealed the Holy of Holies where God dwelt. Inside was the Ark of the Covenant, overshadowed by the cherubim above the mercy seat, where Aaron sprinkled the blood of the atonement. God's presence was revealed by the pillar of cloud by day and of fire by night over the tabernacle. When the tabernacle was finished, there was a week of ceremonies to dedicate it. And during this time, the priests were ordained and consecrated to the service of God. These two young men, Nadab and Abihu, spent 7 days at consecration meetings in the tabernacle, and on the eighth day, they were struck dead. Why? Let us review the circumstances. The ceremonies began with Aaron offering the lamb on the brazen altar. The body of the lamb was placed on top of the unlighted wood on the altar. And then, out from the Holy of Holies, 100 yards away, God sent forth supernatural fire, moving like a stroke of lightning in horizontal direction from the Holy of Holies to the altar, and igniting the wood and consuming the lamb. This offering was thus accepted by God, and foreshadowed the death of the Lord Jesus Christ, put to death by God himself. Let's not forget that we can never understand the death of Jesus Christ until we realize that God the Father put him to death. We read in Isaiah 53:10, "It pleased the Lord to bruise him. He has put him to grief." And Peter said on the day of Pentecost that Jesus was delivered by the determinate counsel and foreknowledge of God. After the sacrifice was consumed by fire from God, Nadab and Abihu prepared to lead the service of worship and praise, the highest service of the tabernacle. Before going into the inner altar, they filled their censers with incense and lighted it. Where did they get the fire? Probably from some convenient flame nearby, perhaps from the mother's hearth, but not from the fire that God himself had lighted and on which the lamb's blood had dripped. Why did they do this? Was it pride in their new position? Did they think that they could originate the ideas of liturgy? We do not know, but when they reached the altar of incense, God struck them dead because they had lighted the fire of incense with flame other than that which God had consumed the lamb. We read that Nadab and Abihu offered unholy fire, strange fire before the Lord, such as he had not commanded them. By the death of Nadab and Abihu, we learn that God hates false worship. These priests lighted the fire of their censers with earthly flames, instead of at the brazen altar where God's fire burned. Now, when God says that he hates something, we should stop, look, and listen. Take your concordance and look at all of the things in the Bible that God says he hates. You will discover quite a few things. Among them, for example, we read in the book of Amos, "I hate, I despise your feasts, and I take no delight in your solemn assemblies. Take away from me the noise of your songs. To the melody of your harps I will not listen." Oh, a church may have the most talented quartet in the city, yet its singing may be only a noise in the ears of God. The people may come with tithes and offerings, but with hearts that are far from God. Some people may even offer rich gifts, a stained glass window, an organ, or even an endowment, but their motive is only to please themselves and to honor their families, perhaps, but not pleasing the God in whose name they profess to give these things. This worship and this devotion God detests. Have you ever noticed that in Hebrews 2:12 the Lord Jesus says, "I will proclaim thy name unto my brethren. In the midst of the congregation, I, Jesus, will praise thee"? This is wonderful. Jesus, in the midst of his church, leads the congregation in the worship of God. Every part of God's service should be under the control of his Holy Spirit. Perhaps the reason some churches do not have too much singing, the reason why the organ must play very loud to cover up the fact that there is no hymn singing from the hearts of the people, is that the Lord Jesus is not praising God from the heart. God hates form and ceremony when they are substituted for worship in spirit and in truth. Now, if we turn to the 6th chapter of 2 Samuel, we see another man whom God struck dead. His name was Uzzah. King David had commanded that the Ark of the Tabernacle be transferred to the new capital city of Jerusalem, and Uzzah seems to have been chairman of the committee in charge of this task. The Ark was placed on a new cart drawn by a pair of white oxen. Probably Uzzah thought, "Oh, this is going to make a big impression at the capital. Nothing like this has ever been seen before. Maybe King David will give me a good job at court. Come on now, onward, Christian soldiers. And as the procession moved toward Jerusalem, the oxen stumbled and caused the cart to wobble. Uzzah put up his hand to steady the ark, and God struck him dead. Now, he was not killed because he touched the ark, because he must have touched it in order to set it on the cart. His sin was that he did not follow God's prescribed method for transporting the ark. What was that method? In 1 Chronicles 15:15, we read that later on the Levites carried the ark of God upon their shoulders with the poles. This was in accordance with detailed instructions in Numbers 4. No one could handle the ark but members of the tribe of Levi, as David himself said in 1 Chronicles 15. No one but the Levites may carry the ark of God, for the Lord chose them to carry the ark of the Lord. Under no conditions was the ark to be touched by unconsecrated hands. So we see that Uzzah's sin was threefold. First, he was not of the priestly tribe, but of the tribe of Judah. Second, he arranged for the ark to be transported in a manner typical of the Philistines, which is described in earlier chapter in Samuel, where the Philistines sent the ark back to Israel on a cart drawn by two cows. And thirdly, Uzzah touched the ark, thus disobeying God's specific command that only the priests should handle it. In 2 Samuel 6, God briefly describes the nature of Uzzah's sin. And the anger of the Lord was kindled against Uzzah, and God smote him there for his error, and there he died by the ark of God. The Hebrew word here translated error is literally rashness. This well describes the attitude of Uzzah. He not only disregarded God's command for transporting the ark, but he had no regard for the consequences of disobedience. He was rash indeed. Thus we can understand that God did not strike Uzzah out of petty anger, but in order to teach his people that God's work must be done in God's way. Just as Nadab and Abihu had brought worship from the human spirit instead of from the Holy Spirit, Uzzah had brought service from the human spirit instead of from the Holy Spirit. Reading the history of the Christian church, you will find that God uses only yielded men who obey his will. Disobedience has been one of the causes of wars of religion. Oh, if we would only throw aside conferences on method and adopt God's way of doing his work, how much better progress we would make. In the early days of the church, deacons and missionaries alike were chosen by the Holy Spirit. In Acts 6:3, we read, "Pick out from among you 7 men of good repute, full of the Spirit and of wisdom." Among these deacons was Stephen, the first martyr, and Philip, who did great work among the Samaritans and led the Ethiopian official to Christ. And how did God choose missionaries? In the church at Antioch, it says, "While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, 'Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them.' And then after fasting and praying, they laid their hands on them and sent them off." Uzzah was struck dead because he tried to serve God in his own way instead of in God's way. This led to tragedy. When we try to run our churches according to the way of the world instead of the ways of God, they will inevitably meet a similar fate. True, we may not see corpses in the church building, but all too often we must cry, as in the Old Testament story, "Ichabod, the glory of the Lord has departed." Our service for God must be performed in the power of the Holy Spirit, not in the energy of the human spirit. Finally, let us turn to the third case where God struck a man dead, this one in the New Testament, the death of Ananias and his wife Sapphira. At the close of the 4th chapter of the book of Acts, we read that one man named Barnabas sold a piece of land and laid the proceeds at the apostles' feet. Undoubtedly, a buzz of admiration went through the congregation who witnessed this act of sacrifice. Ananias and his wife Sapphira probably thought it would be pleasant to hear the congregation buzz admiringly about them. So they sold a piece of property, but kept back part of the money for a rainy day but claimed that they were giving all the proceeds to the Lord. In effect, they sang, "I surrender all," but they did not mean it. Oh, perhaps more lies are told in church than anywhere else in all the world. Where, except in church, will you get hundreds of people to lie together as they sing, "Love so amazing, so divine, demands my soul, my life, my all"? Or, "Since from his bounty I receive such proofs of love divine, had I 1,000 lives to live, Lord, they would all be thine." Many people never give to God the one life they do have, let alone the 999 they do not possess. Peter, however, exposed the depth of the sin on the part of Ananias and Sapphira when he said, "You have not lied to men, but to God." So Ananias fell down and died on the spot. 3 hours later, his wife told the same lie and suffered the same penalty. Why? Because these two believers had made their sacrifice in the energy of the human spirit instead of in the power of the Holy Spirit. Now, some may disagree when I say that I believe that in these three cases, all were believers, saved even as believers today, and that they are in heaven. We're told in John's first epistle, there is a sin unto death. And in 1 Corinthians 11:30, we read that death is a part of God's discipline of his children. For Paul writes, "That is why so many of you are weak and ill, and many have died." In these three stories, we learn of believers who were guilty of spiritual transgression. And as 1 Corinthians 10:11 says, these things happened to them as a warning, but they were written down for our instruction. Someone may ask, does God strike people dead today? I would not be at all surprised that he does in some cases. Certainly, he never deprives a believer of salvation. But disobedience to the will of God definitely leads to disruption of fellowship between God and his child, and results in a life that is barren of the fruit of the Spirit. We may well question whether our coldness and our barrenness and our lack of love does not stem from the personal disobedience of each of us to God's will as we definitely know it. Unfortunately, we rationalize and excuse our condition by blaming it on the unbelief of the world that rejects our message and on the indifference of the church in general. But just as God knew who lighted the strange fire, who touched the ark, who lied to the Holy Spirit, so he knows who is at fault today. And we know also when it is ourselves. Note that each moment when God struck these people dead was at the beginning of a new era in the history of his people. Each instance showed his hatred of disobedience manifested by human effort, not in accordance with his word. At the dedication of the tabernacle, when Nadab and Abihu offered unholy fire before the Lord and were struck dead, God showed that he hates worship from the human spirit. At the beginning of King David's reign, God showed by the death of Uzzah that he hates service offered in the energy of the human spirit. And at the beginning of the church age, he struck down Ananias and Sapphira in order to teach us that he hates surrender from the human spirit. Now, you see, it's very important that we see that these three events took place at the beginning of the Mosaic period, the Davidic kingdom, and the church. If we go out in the country outside of Philadelphia, for example, we may see a sign that says, "New York, 80 miles. Well, we go along a half a mile and we say, "Is this still the road to New York? I don't see a sign here." And there's no sign here. We say, "Well, there was one back at the junction. You don't need a sign now." There's no sign every yard on the road. It's only every crossroad, every few miles. So it is that God does not show us signs at every minute today, but there are signs at the crossroads. You need not lose your way if you look at the way God has marked the road and hear these three tombstones, that of Nadab and Abihu, that of Uzzah, and that of Ananias and Sapphira, are markers that show God's hatred of that which comes from the human spirit, instead of that which comes from the Holy Spirit. Now, as we seek to worship, to serve, and to surrender to our God, let us take heed and do those things which are pleasing to him. He has told us in Colossians 3, "Whatever you do in word or deed, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. Whatever your task, work heartily, as serving the Lord and not men, knowing that from the Lord you will receive the inheritance as your reward. You are serving the Lord Christ. For the wrongdoer will be paid back for the wrong he has done, and there is no partiality with God. We can never serve God apart from the way he has ordained. And the first requirement for serving him is that we shall know him as our heavenly Father through Jesus Christ, our redeeming Savior, who said, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me." We can only worship the Father in spirit and in truth. The truth of his word tells us how to worship him. And his Holy Spirit dwelling within our hearts leads us into true worship. From true worship, true service is bound to flow. A man who truly knows the will of God will always be willing to abide in his way. Such a man will never use the showy methods of the world to attract people to his Lord, as Uzzah did when he followed the methods of the Philistines. And in the light of God's judgment upon Ananias and Sapphira, we should take seriously our surrender to our Lord. We should not commit blasphemy by glibly singing, "I surrender all," when we have no intention of making such a surrender. And we shall never make such an empty boast if we keep before us the fact that we shall have to give an account of the deeds done in the body when we appear before the judgment seat of Christ. God may not judge us here on the spot, as he did in former times. But just as surely as he is in heaven, just so surely shall we give an account to him. So let us keep before us the great exhortation that sums all this up, where Zechariah says, "Not by might, nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord of hosts." Shall we not resolve to exalt the Holy Spirit to complete domination over us? Let us be sure that our worship is in the Holy Spirit, that our service and our surrender are under his direction. Let our work not be merely God's work, but let it be God's work done in God's way. And our God and Father, we pray thee to bless this to each heart. In Jesus' name, amen.